Spirit, rain down, rain down. Oh, comfort her and friend, how we need your touch again. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome again to another midweek Bible study. Of course, as I said before, we've been lagging behind with these teachings. So what we do is to double up on each of these teachings. So welcome, Barrytown, Lilliput, Mount Zion, Farmites, those of you in the wider Caribbean area, or you're in North American region, or you are in the European region. We want to welcome you in a very special way. And welcome to Midweek Bible Study. But as usual, we play a song. We're teaching on the Holy Spirit. And we pray for those who are truly challenged and tested. Listen to Grace Chiloy's again. Brothers and sisters, when the soul caught fire, it will burn out condemnation. Hallelujah. At this time, let us pray. Father, we just praise you for the power of the Spirit that is in the church. You said, when the Spirit of truth is come, he shall teach us all things and bring back all things to our remembrance. You said, you shall pour out your Spirit in the last days our sons and daughters shall prophesy, old men shall dream dreams, and young men see visions. We thank you for the power of the Spirit that is at work, O God, to transform the lives of your people, and even those that are bound and held captive by the power of the Spirit. Words of prophecy can bring life, O God, and healing, restoration to them. Pray for those that are not saved, that they will be transformed by the power of the Spirit, born of the water and the Spirit and the blood. Those that are bound, O God, set them free and release them by your Holy Spirit power. Father, those who are sick and confined to their homes and are truly tested, we ask you, Lord, to rescue them, to relieve them, to set them free, to break them out of the bandage they're in. We just thank you now for being at work in our lives. In Christ's name we pray. Hallelujah. For the ancient word, brothers and sisters. Brothers and sisters, ancient word. We use as our scripture base today 1 Corinthians 12, verse 1 to verse 11. That is 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 1 to verse 11. And it read it thus. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I would not have you ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led. Wherefore, I give you to understand that no one speaking by the Spirit of God called Jesus a curse, and that no one can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Ghost. Now, there are diversities of gifts by the same Spirit, and there are diversities of administrations but the same Spirit. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God who worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every person to profit with all. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirit, to another diverse kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to everyone severally as he will. Wow. That's the word of God. Will you open our eyes to your word, Lord, and speak newness of life to us? As we, O Lord, study your word in Christ's name. So today we look at the Holy Spirit in the local church, and then we will continue as we will see where this takes us. All right? Now, we have so far looked at the Holy Spirit in different forms, the part he plays in the Trinity, his personality, traits and attributes, his duty, his nature, and his general ministry. We have also dealt with the history of the Holy Spirit through the Old Testament and his presence in the life of Christ. We now examine some of the ways he manifests himself in the local church. Now, the Holy Spirit, first of all, in the local church makes us one. There is no way that people from diverse background and ethnicity could really unite themselves under one banner unless the Holy Spirit unite them. Now, I think Paul in 1 Corinthians 12 and 13 says, "For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit." So the Spirit unites the church in the first instance. So the Holy Spirit is the magnet which draws the people of God together, baptizing us in the same body, regardless of our race, color, creed, or, as I said, ethnicity. We are drawn into the same body and become one body, known as the body of Christ, Christ being the head of the church. Members in particular, verse 27 of the same 1 Corinthians 12 tells us that now we are the body of Christ and members in particular. So one body, we are all members of that one body. It is the Spirit of God who makes us one in spite of our differences. It takes the empowerment of the Spirit of God in the life of his church to transform lives and to make us one, to unite us together. Now, the Holy Spirit does not only unite the people of God into one body, the Holy Spirit orders worship. Worship can be at times confusing if it is not ordered and directed by the Spirit of God. If it is just pure intellect and liturgy and emptiness, then it cannot be fulfilling. But when the Holy Spirit orders worship, it brings us together with various talents and expressions that we bring to bear into the worship experience, brothers and sisters. And as we share our gifts and talents in diverse ways, it brings empowerment and strengthens the church. All right? So the scripture provides the procedure for us to perform and to behave when we come into the house of God. Now, John 4 and verse 24 says, "God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." You see, when we come to worship, it's not a social gathering, nor just a formal gathering. When we come to worship, it is an experience into which God enters. And if God enters that experience, it becomes a spiritual experience. And we cannot reach out to God unless the Holy Spirit is there to guide us and bring us into that new atmosphere, that supernatural atmosphere in which communion takes place between us and God. It is not paper and music and hymns. It is more than that. It's an experience into which the Holy Spirit must enter and God must enter. So the Bible tells us that we must come with psalms, with doctrines, tongues, revelation, interpretation, and that will bring to edification. So the Bible says when we come together, Hebrews 3 verse 13, we must exhort one another. Exhort one another. In other words, we are building up each other in the holy faith. 1 Thessalonians 4 and verse 18 says we must comfort one another. So it's an experience which the Holy Spirit guides us to do these things. Colossians 3 verse 16 says, we must teach and admonish one another. And James 5 and 16 says, we must confess our sins to one another. James 5, 14 to 16 says, we must pray for one another. Right? 1 Peter 1 and verse 22, we must love one another. Galatians 6 and verse 2, we must bear one another's burden. So if you're going to do all of these things efficiently so that they can bring edification and healing, then the Holy Spirit must order worship. In order for these things to take place, the Holy Spirit must be in control, right? As the text we read in 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 11 says, but all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every person severally as he will. So all of these gifts that come to bear upon the worshiping community are through the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit unites us. The Holy Spirit orders worship in the local church, and the Holy Spirit provides workers. So every worker who comes to work in the church must be anointed by the Spirit. Remember when we looked at Exodus 31, we see even those who were going to work with stones and gold and all of these practical things, Aholiab and Bezalel, all of these guys were filled with the Holy Spirit. And we also said in Acts that the persons who were going to serve tables, practical work, that they too were to be filled with the Holy Spirit. So apart from the fact that all workers of the church must be properly trained and equipped to perform the various tasks and functions which they have in the church, brothers and sisters, so too they must be empowered by the Holy Spirit. Because it's the Holy Spirit who calls and empowers persons to serve in the ministry of the church. He calls the prophets, the pastors, the teachers, the apostles, the evangelists, and so on. Those who work in government of the church, he calls them and he empowers them. And he gives them various gifts according to the scripture. We read diverse gifts, some prophesy, some discern, and so on and so forth. The Holy Spirit set these persons in the church and operates through them so that they can transform lives. Yes, the Holy Spirit not only calls, equips, and empowers persons to serve and workers, he enables self-exhortation that we can speak to ourselves in psalms and hymns. Hear the Bible. The Bible challenges us to be filled with the Spirit and to encourage ourselves through psalms and spiritual songs, making melody in our hearts unto the Lord, as we see in Ephesians 5 and verse 18 and 19. Believers must learn how to exhort themselves, to encourage themselves through the Spirit, and build up themselves in the most holy faith. Now, the Holy Spirit encourages and enables self-exhortation. He also helps us to pray. Because sometimes we are praying, and praying in the Spirit is very important. Because unless we pray in the Spirit, we cannot break through the satanic atmosphere that is over our region, our churches, our lives. We have to, our prayers must be anointed, too hot to hold, as I always time says. Now, praying in the Spirit is very important. Hear what the scripture tells us, that the Spirit also helps in our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit also makes intercession for us with groaning which cannot be uttered. He that searches the heart knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because he makes intercessions for the saints according to the will of God. Romans 8, verse 26 and 27. So the Holy Spirit knows our innermost thoughts and desires. Paul encourages us that we should pray in the Spirit, brothers and sisters, to gain access to the Father. Though the Father, we cannot gain access before the throne. Remember in Revelation 4 and verse 1 and 2, John says, I was in the Spirit. And as he was in the Spirit, immediately was in the presence of God. He was lifted up and he saw thrones. He saw one sit on the throne. Yes, brothers and sisters. So So the Holy Spirit prays through us. The Holy Spirit also break our yokes and bring us to a place that we can see Him. Once the Spirit is at work, brothers and sisters, sometimes people become slain in the Spirit. And we see this occurs in instances when persons truly encounter the presence of God and they are not able to stand before His awesome presence. Right? Daniel testifies as he saw this great heavenly vision. He says, "There remained no strength in me, for my comeliness was turned into corruption, and I retained no strength. I was in a deep sleep," he says, "on my face, and my face towards the ground." Daniel 10 and verse 7 to 10, right? The Roman soldiers who kept watch at the grave of Jesus fell prostrate on their face, as the stone was rolled away in Matthew 28 and verse 2 to 4. In Revelation 4 and 10, reveals that the elders fall down before him who sit on the throne and worship him, prostrated before him. Brothers and sisters, so sometimes we come to the church and the Spirit of God is at work. And when God's presence fills us and we encounter God's presence, then we cannot help but fall in adoration before him. Now, John saw him, brothers and sisters. And when John saw him on the Isles of Patmos in Revelation 1, verse 9 to 12 and verse 17, John says, "I fell before him." Isaiah, when he beheld his glory, saw his own nothingness in Isaiah 6 and verse 1 to 8. And he says, "Woe is me, I am undone." Moses, when he saw his glory in Exodus 34, verse 5 to 8, Moses was also on his face. No one can truly encounter God and stands. And that is what happens sometimes when we come in the presence of God and the Spirit of God moves. We will always find ourselves broken before him in such a way. Psalm 150, verse 4, Psalm 149, verse 3, encourage us to praise the Lord in such a way and dance before him. So dancing is also something that the Holy Spirit can cause you to dance. Everything must be done for the edifying of all, though, as the Bible says, that whenever we come, it is for the edification of the church. Read 1 Corinthians 14 and 4 and 5. 12, 17, and 26. Nothing must be done for self-glorification and for the exalting of self. It must be for the glory of God and for the edification of the saints. All manifestation of the Spirit, brothers and sisters, must be done to motivate love and must be done to encourage those who come to be healed and to be set free. All right, now, not only that, but as we read in that passage, we recognize that God gives gifts to the church, various gifts to the church. Now, Paul commences the passage we read from 1 Corinthians 12, 1 to 11. He commences in verse 1 by saying, "I would not have you to be ignorant concerning spiritual gifts. The first thing to note is that the gifts of the Spirit is different and separate from the ministry gift. The gifts of the Spirit is a divine endowment on the believer as administered by Christ, while the gift of ministry speak of the supernatural abilities imparted by the Holy Spirit for ministry and mission. And we see that in Ephesians 4 and verse 8 to 14. He gave some apostles, he gave some prophets, he gave some pastors, he gave some teachers. Those are ministry gifts. Paul, speaking of the gifts of the Spirit, however, which is separate and apart from the ministry gifts, he speaks of it in the original Greek and in a threefold way. First, as what we call the charismata. He speaks of it as a variety of gifts bestowed by the same Spirit. 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 4 to 7. The charismata, variety of gifts bestowed by the same Spirit. He also speaks of the gifts as a diakonai, the variety of service rendered in the cause of Christ by the divine enablement of the Spirit. The diakonai. He also speaks of the gifts in the Greek as the energemata, the variety of the power of God who works in all. So the charismata, variety of gifts bestowed by that one Spirit, the diakonai, the variety of service rendered through individual by the divine enablement of the Spirit, and the energy matter, the varieties of power of God who works in all. The main purpose, though, of the gifts of the Spirit is to spiritually enable believers to build up the church of God and not for self-glorification. These gifts are classified in three groupings. We have the gifts of revelation, which include the gift of the word of knowledge, and the gift of the word of knowledge, and then we have the gift of discernment and the gift of the word of wisdom. Those fall under the category of the gifts of revelation. So under the gift of revelation, we have the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, and the gift of discernment. Then under the second category, we have the gift of power. And under the gifts of power, under that category, we have faith, the gift of faith, the working of miracles, and we have healing. And then the final category and classification of gifts is the gift of utterance. And under the gifts of utterance, we have prophecy, tongues, and interpretation. Now the gifts and their meaning. Now the revelation, the gift of revelation, as we said, and its classification, the gift of wisdom falls under that, which that the expression means the utterance of wisdom. It is the ability to discern the meaning of mysteries. The Bible tells us that we oftentimes hear Paul says that some of the things that the Lord has revealed to him, they were mysteries of the kingdom, but they have been revealed to him through the power of the Spirit. It is the divine prudence in dealing with others outside of the church also, for Colossians 4 and 5. And the skills and discern the discretion of imparting Christian truth. You see, a lot of time we impart in Christian truth, but we don't impart it with much wisdom, right? So the knowledge and practical requisition are requisite for godly and upright living. Also, the Bible tells us that is wisdom. So a lot of people say that wisdom is the right application of knowledge, right? So you can have a lot of knowledge, but don't know how to skillfully and successfully apply that knowledge and help to defend the cause of Christ and to also bring people into the body of Christ. So the ability to impart and to apply sacred scriptures and texts in a way that it is done so skillfully is having wisdom. The word of wisdom is therefore the ability to speak above the ordinary, right? Proverbs 9 and 10 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding." So wisdom is the right application of the knowledge, and this is this divine enablement that is given the church to unravel the mystery of Christ and to articulate such a mystery in a powerful way. Now, secondly, under the classification of the gifts of revelation is the word of knowledge, and the word of knowledge refers to a supernatural inspired utterance of facts. It speaks to the ability to dig deep into the knowledge of the things of God and to make them known. Romans 15 and 4, and it is the knowledge and understanding of the depth of the love of God. Ephesians 3 verse 18 to 9, so that you may know the depth of the knowledge of God. I always say that that people should be able to see beyond the obvious, because sometimes we look at the scripture and we cannot unravel it, because you know, we just see the surface of the scripture. We don't see beyond what the Lord is saying. And that's why the Bible says a natural person cannot understand the things of God, neither can they know them, because they are spiritually discerned. So what is the difference between wisdom and knowledge? And as I said, most scholars claim that knowledge is the insight into divine things, while wisdom is the skill which regulates the knowledge and applies it to the Christian life according to its fundamental principles. So while the knowledge is the word of knowledge, will enable you to dig deep and to be able to extract that which God wants to say to his people, you understand it and impart it. The skill to apply it and to impart it is where the wisdom comes in. Now, then we have the next category of gifts. We have the we talk about the classifications, and under the first classification we have the word of knowledge, we have the word of wisdom, and then we have discernment, okay, based on chapter 12 and verse 10, that some people are able to discern. The Bible tells us that many false spirits are gone out into the world. Their work is to seduce the people of God. You can only detect the different spirit if you have the gift of discernment, right? Or if you have that divine enablement, which enables you to determine whether or not the person prophesying the person prophesying is doing so by the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God equips us to see through and to know the true nature of inspiration. There are two ways. There are two other ways apart from the Spirit in which we can detect the Spirit. There are two ways the gift assists us, right, to do this test. The Spirit, to test the Spirit. We call it the doctrinal test, and then we have the practical test. In the doctrinal test, 1 John 1, 4 and verse 1 to 6 says, anyone who confesses that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh and is the Son of God is a true prophet. Then in Matthew 7, verse 15 to 23, he talks about the fruit, by the fruit you shall know them. So a spring cannot send forth sweet and bitter water. A tree cannot send forth sweet orange if it's a sour orange tree. So the fruit of the person will determine whether or not they are of God. Also in terms of the doctrinal test, if what they are saying does not line up with scripture, then you know definitely that that person is not of God. But the Spirit of God will enable you to determine between the true and the false prophet. All right? So that's the discernment. You can look and you can feel and you can sense. Even sometimes people come into the church and they come in with various kind of spirit or baggages on them. They are going through certain hurts and pains, and you know, certain demonic entities are operating in them or through them. The gifts of discernment will enable you to have a kind of sense as to what these people are going through. The second classification of the gift, we have the gift of power, and then we have, on the gift of power, we have first faith. So the gift of faith is special and must be distinguished from the saving faith, because saving faith is just in Christ alone for your salvation. As we see in Romans 10, verse 9 and 10 to 11, that if you believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead and confess him with your mouth, you shall be saved, for you believe, okay? Because with the heart one believeth unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. That is saving faith, the gift of by which we know we receive salvation, is by that faith is saving faith. The kind of faith I am talking about now is the speak of the special endowment of power of the Spirit to enter into the supernatural and to allow certain miraculous happenings. That gift of faith we see also in Elijah, 1 Kings 18 and verse 33. Elijah called on fire to consume the sacrifice on Mount Carmel. That is faith, as he battled up there with the prophet of Baal. All right. So Peter and John going up into the house of prayer in Acts 3 and verse 49, and the man reached out and asked for arms, and he said, "Silver and gold have I none. Such as I have, though I give I thee. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk." That is faith. Faith being put in action. The Bible says we have faith as the grain of a mustard seed. We shall say to the mountains, "Be thou removed into the midst of the sea," and they shall obey. Now, so first under the gift of power is the gift of faith. Faith is the substance of things so far, the evidence of things not seen. It is that which you use to bring the non-realities into reality. Yeah? The Bible says in Hebrews 11 and verse 6 that he that comes to God must believe that God is, and that God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Then we have under the second a gift of power is healing. 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 9 talks about the gift of healing and make mention of this gift in the plural sense. So it says gifts of healing. There are various methods through which people can be healed. Persons can be healed, used of God in a supernatural way to administer healing to the sick in other ways. As James says in James 5 and verse 14 to 15, if there is a sick, you must call for the elders of the church, let them pray over them, anointing them with oil, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick. So God uses people in a supernatural way to pray over people, and the sick is healed. The healing power of God can also be experienced through doctors or medicine. God can guide the hands of those doctors, right? So the person who possesses this gift does not have the power to heal everyone, right? Because it is also hinged on the person's faith, right? So remember Jesus himself, when he was in his hometown, said he could have done much more miracle, but the people doubted that because he was from the community, and they thought he was Mary's son, they doubted him. And as a consequence, more miracles didn't happen. So those who, brothers and sisters, have this power to exercise this gift of healing, right, can administer this gift, operating this gift, that the blind can see, the deaf can hear, right? The blind man walked in the ministry of Jesus, Luke 18, verse 30, 5 to 43. Dumb spirit were made to leave out of people, Mark 9, 14 to 20, 25. And we could go on, and the list goes on. All right? So that is the ability to work, to heal. Right? Some people have healing hands, that it can break yokes and set shackles free, people free of their shackles by just touching them, right? Then we have the working of miracles under that classification. This is, miracle is really to defy the supernatural, not necessarily defying the supernatural, but to defy the law of nature. Miracles is to allow something that by natural means should not be, but yet because of the Spirit of God it occur. This is the work of the power of God. The key word is power, because God uses people. This power is the ability to invoke the supernatural power of God. Moses, for instance, parted the Red Sea. Elijah made ox to swim. 2 Kings 6 and 1 to 6, right? Iron don't swim. And for that iron to swim, it takes miracles, all right? it takes miracles. 5,000 were fed by Jesus Christ with just 5 loaves and 2 fish. So that is a miracle. Okay? So God has given people the ability to pray over people, to invoke supernatural things to happen, and to allow it to be visible to the natural eye. Those are miracles. So that is the second classification. Faith, healing, the work of miracles, which is classified under the gift of power. The last classification is the gift of utterance. And under the gift of utterance, we have prophecy. Prophecy is making utterance inspired by the Spirit. It must be distinguished from ordinary preaching. It is foretelling and foretelling. In other words, you're speaking forth to a situation, and you can be predicting something that will take place in future. All right? So it operates in both ways. The prophet is to edify, exhort, and comfort the believer. The believer is encouraged to judge the prophet, lest they speak a vision of their own heart and not of the mouth of the Lord. 1 Corinthians 14:29, right? So when a prophet is speaking, we should be able to judge them through the power of the Spirit to find out if what they are saying is true. So a powerful proclamation of the gospel under the inspiration of the Spirit of God. And the anointing is also equivalent to prophecy. Tongues and interpretation is also equivalent to prophecy. All right? So under the gift of utterance, we have prophecy, foretelling and foretelling. We have tongues, right? And some people feel that everybody should speak in tongues, but not necessarily so. It's a gift. The gift of tongues is the power to speak supernaturally a language you never learned. There are two kinds of messages can be given in tongues. One is ecstatic praise addressed to God alone. And the message, and the second one is a message addressed to the church through interpretation. Read 1 Corinthians 14. So there are two types of tongues. Acts 2 talks about other tongues. Okay? The people were all in one place, in one accord, and suddenly there was a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the place where they were, and they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave utterance. Now, other tongues mean that somebody somewhere in the world speaks that language. Remember now, in the book of Acts, there were different people from different places there, and everybody could hear the message in their own language. That's other tongues. Now, in 1 Corinthians 14, the Bible speaks of unknown tongues. And this is a tongue that is not known to anyone. Okay? But yet, if it is spoken in the church or otherwise, then it can and should be interpreted for edification. Now, there are a lot of people who get up and begin to speak in tongues, but don't prophesy. Because if you're speaking in tongues, God will allow you to prophesy, or somebody in the congregation to prophesy. If there's nobody there to prophesy and you're not allowed to prophesy, then the Bible says you should speak to yourself and to God. Okay? And that is clear. When we come back, we're going to be looking on the regulation of tongues. So we, under the gifts of utterance, we have prophecy, we have tongues, and we have interpretation of tongues. Okay? So the speaking of tongues and the interpretation of tongues is equivalent to prophecy. And if there is no, God has enabled you to speak in other tongues, that means he wants a message to be communicated to somebody who speaks another language. And we have heard of missionaries who go into different places and they were able to speak in languages that the people could understand, although they are English speaking. So those are other tongues, right? Unknown tongues, most of the time we speak it to God or for our personal edification. If it is spoken in the church, the Bible says that we must interpret it. So we should not just go on speaking tongues and everybody speaking in tongues and there is no interpretation and nobody understands what is being said to the congregation. Paul says people will come and say that we are mad, right? And we don't understand what we are saying. And that is true. We must be able to interpret it if it is unknown tongues, or God will allow somebody within the same worshiping community to interpret. When we get back, we talk about the regulation of the gifts and how they should be regulated in the church. And we look at 1 Corinthians 14. The Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. Make his face shine upon you and lift up his countenance upon you in Christ. Hallelujah.
How we need your touch again.